trips to the U.S., where the final presidential debate has just wrapped up in Nashville. President Trump and his Democratic rival Joe Biden tussled over six topics, from the coronavirus to race relations to immigration. For more on this, we cross live to our Washington correspondent, Ketevan Gorgestani. Now, Ketevan, the debate has just wrapped up. What were the big defining moments for the two candidates?
Well, first of all, we were actually able to listen to the candidates, to listen to what they had to say, to hear them actually express themselves and express their ideas compared to that chaotic first presidential debate. The other thing is that, as expected, the major topic and the one where you saw probably one of the most memorable lines of the night was the topic of coronavirus. COVID-19 was the first of the six segments, and Joe Biden went on the offense right away, attacking Donald Trump, saying basically that someone who is responsible for this many deaths, remember there are more than 215,000 deaths here in the United States, someone who is responsible for those deaths should not be allowed to remain as the president of the United States. That was his main message, and then he continued attacking Donald Trump on his handling of the coronavirus. Donald Trump, who tried to say that he was taking some responsibility for his handling of the coronavirus, but then deflected and blamed China for sending that plague upon the world and upon the United States. There was another pretty tense exchange over the question of race with Donald Trump, repeating a line that he said multiple times in the past, that he is the president who has done the most for the African-American community, and that he's probably the best president for African-Americans since Abraham Lincoln. And Joe Biden did not let that one slide, saying that Donald Trump was probably the most racist president this country had ever had, and that he was pouring fuel on every single racist fire. So Joe Biden was actually more on the offense than a lot of people expected. And maybe Donald Trump was a little bit less aggressive than expected, especially on his attacks about Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden. He had been building that up for days now leading up to this debate. But in the end, he made allusions, he made insinuations, but no, not really any direct focused attacks on Hunter Biden.
All right. Thank you, Ketevan Gorgestani, our correspondent in Washington, reporting live for us there. But for now, we're going to come back to Paris in our studio again with Doug Herbert, our international affairs commentator.
Good morning.
Now, the debate has just wrapped up. Did it move the needle at all?
Did it move the needle? Well, look, we're going to have to see what all the snap polls say and what the spin says. I think that basically both candidates basically said what they had to say to their own constituencies. Whether or not Donald Trump was able to reach it all beyond his base, or whether he even tried to do that, wasn't apparent from this debate. What was apparent was the starkly divergent philosophies, ideologies, and approaches to the pressing problems of our day from both of these men. It wasn't just ideological nuance here. This was not just a Republican candidate against a Democratic candidate. These were men whose visions of America were so radically different that you take the coronavirus pandemic, and that is what the debate started on, and they spent a good chunk of the opening parts of the debate. Donald Trump's vision basically hewing to, and his rhetoric on it, hewing to exactly what it's been since the beginning, that this is sort of a blip in the radar. It's going to go away soon. He originally said it was going to go away when the warm weather came in the summer. Well, that didn't happen, so he had to adjust and moderate the rhetoric. He's still, though, echoing tonight that sort of, you know, better times are ahead, brighter days are ahead, everything's going to sort of disappear and we'll all live happily ever after. Joe Biden, not to be an alarmist, but you would say perhaps he was being a realist because he's listening to the scientists. And his vision was that, no, actually, happy days are not here just yet at all, not by a long shot. We are in for a dark winter on the coronavirus, which means hunkering down a lot. And he started out by saying, basically, I will end this. I will take care of this. I have a plan. So he tried to start out with a reassuring message to Americans. But right away, that fundamental clash on fundamentally different approaches to this pandemic. And this coming amid, the context is everything here. Because remember, we're speaking about a U.S. election, battleground states being important here. And in the battleground states that Donald Trump really needs to win to have any chance at this election, the Iowas, Ohio's, the Michigan, Wisconsin, the Pennsylvania, Arizona, Florida, the cases are trending up, coronavirus cases and deaths. And that is a concern. And Americans themselves, a majority, think that things are going to get worse with the coronavirus pandemic before they get better.
All right. Thanks, Doug Herbert, for that analysis. We're going to go back to our guest now, David Schultz, who's joining us earlier during our special coverage on this final presidential debate. He's a political science professor at Hamline University in St. Paul, Minnesota. Now, as we've mentioned during this program, David, Trump came into this debate trailing in the polls. Biden is leading polls nationally and also in some key swing states. But can we really trust polls after 2016? Have polls changed at all? In the meantime, is there a new method? How can we trust these polls, or should we?
Okay, two things. First, the polls are exactly on score 4 years ago when they said that Hillary Clinton would win by about 2 to 3 percentage points in the national polls, plus or minus 2 or 3 points. They were deadly accurate at the national level. But remember, it's not about national polls, about national popular vote. It's about the swing states. It's about, as Doug pointed out here, it's about those critical states like Pennsylvania and so forth. But even at the swing state level 4 years ago, the polls were accurate. So one of the, I think, false narratives from 4 years ago is that the polls didn't capture it and what was happening in the race, and they largely did. And I think this year, one of the things we're seeing also is that for the last 6 months, at the national level, the stability between Biden and Trump in the national polls have been very, very accurate in terms of stable, I should say. And in the critical swing states, they've been fairly stable. And the reason why I mention this is that I really think at this point, first, to answer your question even more directly, the polls were accurate then. I think they're accurate right now. But the challenge now for Donald Trump is the fact that there's not a lot of swing voters left. There's been a lot of early voting taking place. He needed to do something tonight to really sort of reverse the trajectory of the campaign. And I don't think he did it tonight in terms of altering where anything is going to go. And that becomes his difficulty with, what, essentially 10 days to go, with so few voters in so few swing states to move at this point that it's just not clear that he was successful in terms of what he really needed to do. And I'm not sure that there is much he can do at this point.
I'm going to bring in Doug Herbert now.
Yeah, I was just going to, and just speaking of that, I kept saying that Trump has always defaulted. He has never really tried to expand beyond his base. His approval rating Correct. Has held essentially steady throughout his 4 years of the presidency, low 40%, which is traditionally very low for a president towards the end of the first term. And very few presidents, maybe David knows better than I do, have actually been reelected with such low approval ratings when they're seeking reelection. It was interesting, the part about racism in America, because obviously one of the big groups that has been more of a boon to Biden than to Donald Trump has been Afro-Americans, Black Americans. And this is the reason, perhaps, you remember Joe Biden was counting on the Black vote in South Carolina to bring him through. He thought that was going to be what would clinch it for him. And against all odds, it actually happened. I'm wondering tonight, you know, and we heard this debate and he said, and he repeated with vehemence what he said in the past, I am the least racist person in this room. I have done more for Black Americans than any president since Abraham Lincoln, so on and so forth. Was he pitching, actually, to try to get a few more Black voters? Was he pitching at that demographic? Or was he actually sticking to his base? Was he just speaking to his white voters to reassure them that they're not voting for a racist? It's not actually clear with Donald Trump who he was actually speaking to, because it's not necessarily clear that he was speaking to Black voters and whether that would have even convinced Black voters. It seems more that it was, once again, a throwaway line, raw meat, if you will, for his base. They call me racist. Don't worry. We know, you know, I'm not a racist.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, Doug Herbert. And thank you again to our guest, David Schultz, political science professor at Hamline University. And thank you as well to our Washington correspondent, Ketevan Gorgestani. All three of you contributed to our special coverage of this final U.S. presidential debate. And France 24 will continue to cover this debate in the hours to come. So do stay tuned for more of that.